respect to ensuring local community needs are being prioritized. Visit PacificaElections2010.org to download a nomination package and contact the local election supervisor, Oriana Soportas, at 510-250-2471. Nominations close Monday, July 19th.
And this is 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. It's 2:30. Up next is Education Today.
Good afternoon and welcome to Education Today. I'm your host, Kitty Kelly Epstein. This is a program, Education Today, which deals in general with issues affecting education and youth. Since almost everything is connected to young people, we're going to veer a bit away from the education arena and talk to another local important issue which is having a great impact on young people. I know that anybody who's been alert and awake following any form of media in the last few days has heard about the verdict in the Meserly trial. And so we won't be reviewing that, either its political dimensions or its legal dimensions, not the accuracy or the history of what happened, because I think everyone knows that a young black man was shot by a BART officer on the platform of the Fruitvale BART station in Oakland, which has had a tremendous impact on young people in Oakland, partly because it was viewed by video, and partly because this is a place that's very central to the life of Oakland. Many, many young people take the BART station right there where Oscar Grant was shot, and they and their parents can imagine this, something like this happening to them, and that is part of the reason why it's had such a powerful emotional resonance within the city. So we know that. I think most people listening to KPFA in the Bay Area do know that. But one thing people haven't got to hear so much about in the media discussions is what young people actually think. It isn't common for the media to ask questions to young people and then listen deeply to their responses in any sort of length. And one opportunity to do that occurred last night at the rally which took place near City Hall in Oakland. And I was there, I listened a lot, and I was very impressed by the ideas that I heard young people sharing. And the kind of unified position a lot of young people took on this movement around the relationship between police and youth and the proper punishment of police, how police abuse should be dealt with, and what the future for young people looks like, all of those issues were contained a lot in this rally. And what I heard was just about every speaker making two kinds of points, not in all in exactly the same words or even completely the same content. But all the young people were saying, this is an injustice, it's terrible, we need a movement, we need to change the kinds of things that can allow this to happen. And at the same time, they were saying, we're all in this together, we're Oakland, and we don't want to tear up our city. So no matter how militant, and many people were very militant about the demands, all were in this kind of unified position about Oakland. And I think this is a reality in Oakland, that people in Oakland really do see themselves as special and kind of in a vanguard of sorts of the movement for social justice in the United States. Every young person knows the Panthers were born in Oakland. Most young people know there are a lot of other movements that were born here. Some know about the sleeping car porters, the beginning of black trade unionism in Oakland. A lot of people know, you know, various parts of the history, the anti-war history that happened here, the free speech movement. A lot of people in Oakland feel really intensely that it's an incredibly progressive place, and of course that our federal representatives have also represented that kind of meaning, you know, with Barbara Lee most recently being in Congress representing Oakland. So I think that's kind of inbred in people's thought process, and I thought it was reflected a lot yesterday. What happened afterwards and the breaking of store windows and looting and so on, I think not very many people thought that had anything to do with getting justice around a murder. And I think that very clearly young people said that wasn't something that they really felt a part of, except in very, very small numbers. So I thought our listeners might be interested in hearing from some young people, because I got to be there, but most of our listeners didn't. And so since you don't get that from the mainstream media, that it might be interesting to hear what some young people are saying about that movement and what they think its implications are for youth in the Bay Area in general, and perhaps in the country as a whole. So we'll be talking to a few people, and then at the end I want to provide a couple pieces of important education news from the U.S. Department of Education, and we'll do that at the end. We're going to be talking first with a young woman with a powerful history herself in Oakland as an activist, and she's going to tell us about her thoughts. We'll ask other young people to call in, and others of you adults who may want to hear or ask questions are welcome to call also. And that telephone number is 510-848-4425. That's our number for calling in, 848-4425. So I believe we have on the telephone Chinyeri Tudashinde, who is who lives in Oakland and does some work with a youth organization. Welcome to Education Today.
Thank you.
Hi. And I'm having a little trouble hearing you. Are you speaking right into the...
Can you hear me better now?
That's better. Okay.
Okay.
And if we have more trouble, I'll let you know, and maybe we'll have to call back.
Okay.
So I wondered if you could just tell us what your thoughts are on this whole movement and these events.
Well, I mean, I can speak a little bit about what I observed yesterday and kind of my reactions around that. I feel that the rally yesterday, kind of like what you said, was for the most part fairly positive and fairly unifying. I think that young people are in a place right now, just frustration, not necessarily even with just the verdict, but just the event in itself, and having to see that repeated over and over in on media and in various forms. And then the verdict kind of just compounded that with one more example of how justice isn't really taking place. So there was a lot of frustration, but there was definitely a unifying voice saying that we wanted to make sure that people were safe and that justice happened, and that we're not tearing up our city, but that people's voices are heard. And I think that was the kind of the main unifying voices, is that people wanted to make sure that they were heard, that they had a space to be heard.
And can you say something about your role? What kind of work are you doing? Are you doing some kind of youth organizing, I think?
Yeah, I work with an organization called Youth Together, and we do organizing work in the East Bay. We work currently now in four different high schools, three in Oakland and one in Richmond. Before that, we were in a couple of more and some in Berkeley. We have been around for the past 14 years and have a really strong history with working with youth and training them to organize and to bring change about in their schools and in their communities.
So I'm familiar with some of the work of Youth Together, and I am very impressed with how much they do on a school campus to bring unity. I believe one of the original events or issues that Youth Together took up was some interracial conflict at Castlemont High School, and they created an organization which actually had an impact on that, and I know on other campuses too. So I'm really impressed with the work of the organization, and I wonder if you are working on any issues that relate to the Meserly verdict in any kind of way in terms of organizing youth, and what you see about the potential for organizing, the kinds of demands that may be being raised, and that type of thing.
Well, currently our main focus, I think that it does have definitely has something to do with the Meserly case, but it's around just the conditions that are happening in our schools, and really the inadequate funding that's going on, and how the priorities within the state and within the country as a whole aren't education, and trying to not just get adequate funding, but really equitable funding into the school system, so that with that, you have students and young people who are connected to their communities, who are connected to the larger community as a whole, and can really be helpful and can give back because they feel valued. And I feel that that lack of value and that sense of value is one of the things that's really expressed when was at the Speak Out yesterday. And while young people are so frustrated is because they don't feel the same type of value.
And do you have ideas, strategies around the education funding issue yourself?
Yeah, well, currently we're in communication with several different grassroots organizations throughout the Bay Area, and some of our ideas are around really fixing the funding system, the making it really transparent, and trying to do maybe student weighted formulas and fixing the formula, the tax formula.
Fixing the tax formula. Wonderful.
Yes. And so currently it's really... it's very different, and you have people in government and in education whose responsibility it is to know it, and they can say that they're not really sure how everything is done because it's just really confusing and inadequate.
So you'd like to simplify it in some kind of way that young people could and everybody else could understand it better and have more control over it?
Yeah, and not just to make it really simple and transparent, but also really to make it equitable. So we're working with our young people and giving them the skills to organize around this issue, but really just to be able to be organizers and active community members. So it's important that we organize to fix the school system, but it's also really important that young people have the skills to be able to bring about the change that they want to see.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like a wonderful organizing campaign. And do you, just to wrap up, have any thoughts yourself about what you feel would lead to greater justice around the Oscar grant, more broadly defined issue? What needs to be done? People feel this is an injustice. How can that injustice be rectified, both in this particular case and in general in the legal system?
I think that in this particular case, I think people would have wanted to see harsher verdict. So an involuntary manslaughter verdict was really felt like a slap on the wrist. I think that that would have been the beginning to kind of give some semblance of justice, because people look at it, and young people in particular, a lot of the examples that I hear and people saying is, you know, if I did it, I would have been put away for second degree or first degree murder. Mm-hmm. But looking at what happens with when black and brown youth are in the similar situations and the kind of justice that they get, the kind of verdicts that they get handed down, and they're able to really see how racist the system is and how that racism is being played out. So I think that would be one semblance of kind of starting to enact some justice. The other one is starting to really call it for what it is, to look at the whole system and be able to see how racism has played a role in that. So starting to give young people that knowledge and that language, I feel, would be really key.
So that people can see that it's sort of systemically oriented, where he...
Yes.
The training, the selection of police, what they
of all of it,
they have. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And when you're able to really see it for a system, then you can really get to the root cause of it. But without that, then we're looking at one incident. And by making it one incident, then it's really frustrating for young people, and it becomes really a disservice and an injustice. By looking at it as just the murder that happened to Oscar Grant, but looking at it as a systemic problem how racism really plays a role in that.
Thank you. That's very helpful. If you want to hold on a minute, I'll see if we have other callers, and some of them may want to dialogue with you as well as with me if you have a few more minutes for us.
Actually, I have to. I'm in the midst. I'm a little lost. I'm driving somewhere.
Oh, dear.
So if there's a way that possibly I could call back or somebody could call me back in about 15 minutes, that would be helpful.
Okay. We might be almost finished by that time.
Oh, okay.
If we get somewhere near and we can do that. Thank you so much for being on the phone with us. It sounds like the work you're doing is great, and I hope you'll stay in touch with the program in the future and let us know more about what you're doing.
Definitely. Thank you so much for having me.
Sure. So This is Education Today on KPFA 94.1. Today we're talking with young people about their reactions to the overall issues embodied in the Messerly verdict, and with the understanding that a lot of times the complete analysis that young people have about an issue doesn't get heard because the speakouts and other events that they hold are maybe, even if they're reported on, their kind of thorough thinking about the issue doesn't get shared. We have a caller with us now, Eric from Oakland. Welcome to Education Today.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, I'm Eric Adams. I work with our city council.
Welcome to Education Today, and we're discussing the response that young people have to the issues surrounding the Messerly verdict and whether it seems likely that there can be some kind of movement for greater justice in the relationship between police and youth in particular, if you have ideas about that.
Well, just breaking down the first part of that question about, like, youth response to the verdict and, like, what's going on. I can honestly say that as a youth, I actually just graduated, but, as a youth, I felt really betrayed by the justice system. I don't feel like it was a just system at that point, because a man who looked like me and was from one of the same areas as I am, who wasn't actually doing anything wrong, was actually struck down for no reason, and the man who perpetrated the crime got a maximum of 4 years. I mean, it was mind-blowing to me, and I feel like as a youth, I feel like I expected a harsher punishment. I feel like as a person of color, especially a youth of color in Oakland, I have seen a lot of harsh punishments come down on my peers for things that are not murder, things that are, you know, art on the side of a wall or things like that. And I feel like to see a man, I feel like I didn't want to take it to the place of a race issue because I feel like it's actually a lot broader than that. It's not just one particular instance of race. It's actually a broader system of institutional racism. But I feel like my response to that was really just rage because I've seen people close to me be put down for things that are nowhere close to murder, and yet, you know, they have been put into the justice system and are still not out.
Very profoundly put. And I believe, knowing a bit of your history in All City Council, that you are an activist and an organizer. And do you have ideas about how to organize around this issue?
Definitely. At this point, we need as much healing as we can. I think that in the midst of seeing that there are things that happen at a higher level in the justice system that do not benefit our needs or do not hold our justice as close tenants, I think that we as a community, and, you know, and that completely includes, you know, city officials, civil servants, I think that we as a city and as a community need to come together and try to create some kind of healing, because this is not just, you know, one issue of a black man being killed by a policeman. It's an issue of we are people of color in a city where, you know, in a world where we have seen that this happens to, you know, people of color, and we as a community need to come together and say, we're not going to let that happen anymore. I think that one of the ideas is that we need to actually have some kind of a bridge program where we can talk to police. I think that police should be from Oakland. If you're going to be a police person in Oakland, you should be from there. I think that there definitely needs to be more of a tie-in with community organizing. I feel like there's a really big divide between what happens at a city level and what happens in the community. And I think that I personally know a lot of people who do a lot of the work to make that, to bridge that divide. But I think there needs to be more of an effort on both sides, specifically on the side of the police. Because I know personally that I might not have the best relationship with police, but if it's going to mean that, you know, the people in my neighborhood aren't brutalized or aren't looked at like criminals, I would definitely take the extra step to make sure I get to know a policeman.
But
there's a lot of misconceptions around like what policemen do, and I feel like there is actually a lot of fear. I mean, I personally would not walk up to a policeman and just ask him a random question as I am now. There is a lot of fear. I have a lot of fear, and I think that the community has a lot of fear because we've seen that the police don't necessarily work for us. I've seen a lot of people, you know, I live in East Oakland. I've seen people, you know, mass groups of people being taken off to jail. And I don't know why. I don't know what they did, but it doesn't, you know, it doesn't make me feel better to know that I see people who look like me in the backs of police cars, and I always see them being the ones taking them away. That doesn't connect well for me.
Thank you, Eric. I think your ideas about organizing are ones that may very well be taken up in the city, both the idea of the bridge program, and that's kind of two-way understanding, with the police also needing to understand what's problematic from the community's feel with them, and then your whole issue about the need for police to live in the city. And I know there are cities that have that kind of a rule. I think people need to look into how that can be done, because there are some regulations that make it difficult, but I have heard this from other people, and I really appreciate you calling in to talk with us. Thank you. And our next caller is Adama from Oakland. Welcome to Education Today.
Hi. I was there at the rally last night. I went to go see for myself what I was being heard reported on the news.
Great.
And so what came up for me while I was there was the realization that being there in that moment, it was about being present with what's happening and not being stuck in the past. And not falsely projecting on what we think should have been occurring. What I mean by that, there was a lot of people, young people, who were taunting the police and trying to provoke them into some type of behavior so they could catch them in a wrong act. And I really appreciated seeing several people intervene and diffuse that and dissipate that energy.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, my question is, what would it be like to have more of that dissipation of, when something is uprising, it's becoming a problem, there's people out there on the street level to diffuse it in that moment. So it doesn't become a violent situation. And that's what I noticed wasn't reported on the news, that there were people there intervening.
So that's a wonderful point, and it's something I've been thinking a lot about the last few weeks, because it's going to be difficult to have a movement for social change, particularly around this issue, unless the movement is able to essentially police itself. Because I heard somebody else on KPFA talking this morning about the kind of discipline that labor unions bring to a situation sometimes, because they do police themselves. And so when they're making a demand or having a sit-in or whatever, it's all unified. And that definitely around this is not the case, at least at this point. So I think your point is really an important one. And if there is to be a further movement around this, that whole ability to give security to the movement itself without having to have it be police security, because then, of course, there's the whole thing of, are the police handling it properly?
Yes.
So I think you're making a really good point. Yes, go right ahead.
And the people who were diffusing it that I saw, it was across the color line. It was, you know, a white guy. One time it was a black woman. They were older, like they looked like 40s and their 50s, who were the ones who were being those peacemakers. And they weren't there. It wasn't their job to do that. They were just walking by and wandered over because it was like, oh, what's escalating right now? So also my thing is to be encouraging of everybody to go out to these these movements and be present, and not just to have it be a certain population, a certain segment, so that we can all know what's going on.
There, I think that's a really good point. There was both formal and informal organizing of that kind of intervention, I believe. There were a lot of emails that went around calling upon the elders, quote, to come out and, take care of our young people. And then Isaac Taggart and some other people organized organized peacemakers with yellow vests and so on, orange vests. And I believe it was very effective and did diffuse several situations. So I agree with you, and I think you're making a really important point, and thank you for calling in.
Thank you. Bye.
We're talking today to people about youth response and movement around the Meserle verdict, and you may call in to 848-4425. We have a couple more minutes that we could take callers. And in the meantime, I want to report on this piece of education news. July 1 was a significant day in the U.S. Department of Education, and this is one of the most, I think, progressive things they've done thus far. They've actually made some changes in the federal process of getting student loans for higher education, and they eliminated the bank-based federal family education loan. So all new federal student loans are going to be made through the direct loan program so that students will borrow directly from the U.S. Department of Education instead of borrowing from banks. And this change, according to the Congressional Budget Office, is going to save the federal government $68 billion over the next 11 years by not paying bank rates, but instead loaning the money themselves. And so this, they say, is one step closer to achieving the president's goal of having the highest proportion of college graduates in the world by 2020, something I consider a very good goal. And in addition, this is going to help with the Pell Grants, because the cost savings that are generated from this transition to student loans will enable an increase in the maximum federal Pell Grant for the 2010-2011 school year to $5,550, which is an $800 increase. So it's good on two levels. First, it's going to be a way that's going to save the government a lot of money, and people will be borrowing directly from the federal government. And then it's going to allow an increase in the actual Pell Grants, which many, many people need to use to finance their student loans. So I think it's a significant change, and one thing to really congratulate the Obama administration's education policy for doing. We have one more caller, Jean. Welcome to Education Today.
My name is Luke.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, Jean.
Hi. I just have something to say. I'm a Chinese person. I'm a mother of a 17-year-old teenager who is very dedicated young person and has been always a big student leader in her 30-some hundred people high school. And at this point, I think the verdicts tell her that, you know, how distrust she can become to our justice system. I think she has been completely turned off at this point. I'm very upset.
So she's been turned off because she feels that the verdict was not just.
That's true. She said the justice has not been served.
Well, it's and is she an organizer, I believe you're saying?
Well, she wished she could be there in Oakland yesterday. But what happened was, you know, there is something else going on that she was in a class in UC Berkeley.
I see.
So then I want to bring out something about National Public Radio, NPR station. I was in a car at exactly 4:30, they delivered this news. But the way they said it was very strange to me, because I know, you know, I can miss one or two words sometimes with my English. So what they said was the verdict was involuntary manslaughter. To me, you know, I heard it for three times. I couldn't figure out it was involuntary manslaughter or voluntary manslaughter. It was very, very strange.
I see. Thank you for calling to tell us your daughter's reaction, and it's an important one for college students and high school students, and for sharing your own experience. One thing I wanted to point out, just as a somewhat of an aside on the verdict, is because Meserly was convicted with a gun enhancement, I believe the sentence is 5 to 14 years rather than 2 to 4, which is the usual sentence for involuntary manslaughter. So that has been a little bit of confusion in the press of late, but I believe that's the more correct. I appreciate everyone for calling in and sharing their thoughts. This is, for us in the Bay Area, a really pretty important moment, and I appreciate hearing from you what you're thinking about it. I'm Kitty Kelly Epstein. I'm your host for Education Today. We air every fourth Friday of the month at 2:30 in the afternoon. The producers for Education Today are Kevin Cartwright and Jaron Epstein. The board op for today's program is Erica Bridgman. We're so happy to have her back here. And we'll be talking with you all again next time. Thanks. Bye-bye.
Of the 25th Jewish Music Festival takes place Sunday, July 11th and Sunday, July 18th in San Francisco. Check out the world premiere of Dan Plonzi's Bar Mitzvah with Dandelion Dance Theater at the Contemporary Jewish Museum on the 11th. On Sunday, July 18th, direct from Marseille, France, catch Watch a Clan, a brilliant Berber, Algerian, Sephardic,